spread to all the other cities of Europe and indeed beyond that. I have several phone calls over a year from places as far apart as China and Russia and Indonesia. They're all interested in green capital. They all want to know how you do it. And we're here to discover a bit about that tonight. One of the things which marks out the people who are leading in green capitals is their vision. And we'll hear from a couple of visionaries tonight who are indeed the mayors of Bristol and of Ljubljana. And they will tell you more about their vision for how their city should progress towards sustainable development and towards 2050. And I hope that will be very interesting for you. Before we start, then, to mark that an event like this is a social event as much as an environmental event, we're very happy to have a young cellist who's going to entertain us in a few seconds. His name is Bernardo Brizzani. He has studied in Florence, and just 2 days ago, he finished his master's in music in Dortmund in Germany, in Detmold, I beg your pardon, in Germany. So today, we are honoured to have him among us, and this is his first public performance since he finished his master's. So, Bernardo, welcome to the stage. Bernardo is going to play two pieces for us tonight. The first piece will be a Bach prelude from his first suite for solo cello. And the second piece will be a piece by from a Slovenian composer called Skerjens, and it will be the first of 5 lyric melodies for cello. Bernardo, thank you very much. Thank you. Bernardo, thank you very much indeed. I think most of us would have liked to listen to far more of that during the evening, but there we are, something of taste for the future. I'd now like to introduce Professor Paul Eakins. Professor Eakins is a professor of economics. He's a prolific author, and some of you might be familiar with his books, which at a glance look as though they are trying to make a link between Gaia, Mother Earth, and macroeconomics. Now that's putting it just in four words, and Paul is already grinning in my general direction, so I've probably got it wrong. But I hope you'll be able to make some links between the excellence which the cities try to aim for when they're applying to be a green capital, and something about modern economics and the way in which that should work for a better environment, if that's not too tall an order. Professor Eakins, thank you very much indeed.
Well, thank you very much, Nicholas, and it is a pretty tall order, and I'm probably not going to fulfill it, because I've been asked to be a bit light-hearted on this celebration, and you will all know that economics is the dismal science. So I'm not going to dwell too much on it, but I am going to say that it's a huge pleasure to be here, and I feel a kind of relationship with both these cities that we're celebrating this evening. With Bristol, obviously, because it's an English city, and I'm English, and I love it, and I have many friends there, and it's a lovely place. Ljubljana, I'm ashamed to say, I have never visited. Thank you very much. I will take you up on that. But I kind of feel I know it a bit through my friendship with the previous Environment Commissioner, Janusz Potocznik, whom I got to know as the Vice Chairman of his Economists Expert Group on Resource Efficiency and the Circular Economy. And more recently, he's co-chair of UNEP's International Resource Panel, on which I'm also a member. He's a quite remarkable and delightful man. And if Ljubljana is anything like him, then it is a very special place indeed. And I want to celebrate two of the things that happen last year in this rather troubled world in which we currently live, which for me are an enormous source of hope and inspiration. And of course, this whole award for European Green Capital of the Year is intended to be a source of hope and inspiration. First, I'm going to mention the Paris Agreement on climate change. I spend most of my academic life working on energy and climate change. And I must say, for the first time, it looked to me as if the global community was beginning to take this very serious issue seriously. And obviously, signing a bit of paper does not reduce greenhouse gas emissions by one ton. And we will need to see what the implementation of that agreement is. But the European Union, I think, can be proud of its leadership role in this area. And that, I think, was a triumph of diplomacy, of European diplomacy, of French diplomacy, and of global common sense. And so that was one enormously encouraging thing. And the other, which I still can't quite believe, was what happened in September. Now, there's a lot of words up there, and they are the 17 Sustainable Development Goals, which were agreed by the global community to embody the aspiration of humanity for 2030 and beyond. They are absolutely remarkable. And I'll leave them there for a minute or two for you to read just how remarkable those aspirations are. They are the embodiment of European and global civilization. And they especially embody an aspiration for humans to forge a new relationship with the natural world, with the green world. Many of them are asking for sustainable use of natural resources and the environment, which of course is what green cities seek to achieve. And we also, of course, if I point you to goal 8, seek to continue to improve our standard of living. And that, in a way, is where the challenge starts. So here is the kind of picture that the International Resource Panel generates many of. And you can see the enormous increase in the use of natural resources since 1980, when that series starts. Biomass, the green, minerals, fossil fuels, and metals, the blue, at the top. Now, it is a scientific fact that we live in a physically finite world. Population is increasing and is likely to reach 9.5 billion by 2050. The middle class globally is increasing, and there are likely to be another 3 billion people currently consuming well below what we as Europeans consume on average, who aspire to consume as much as we do. And that will lead to much increased extraction of resources and far greater environmental impacts in a world where many environmental impacts are already straining at the very boundaries of what these scientists called the safe operating space for humanity. One of those red danger areas, of course, is the climate area, but there are others: nitrogen use and biodiversity loss, and I won't go round the 7 because this is a celebration of positive achievement, but we must always remember the challenge against which that achievement is being set. And this is kind of a signature picture of the International Resource Panel, because we all aspire to greater human well-being. Many of us also aspire to being richer, and that's the red line, economic activity measured by GDP. The only way we can achieve that goal into the medium and long-term future is by decoupling GDP growth from both resource use, the resource decoupling that you see, and especially from environmental impact, the reduced environmental impact in the green line at the bottom. That, of course, is what world leaders committed themselves to do with greenhouse gas emissions in Paris. But we also know from the World Health Organization that we have similar problems with other forms of air pollution, which are greatly impacting the health of Europeans, but most especially people in other parts of the world. And that leads us to something that the current Environment Commissioner is now very much focused on, and indeed the European Commission as a whole: the dream and vision of a circular economy. An economy where we value materials and do not allow them to become wastes, and we manage them through technology and through good behavior and awareness. And that's where cities come in. They have an enormous role to play in this challenge of sustainability. Most of us live in cities. 80% of UK citizens live in cities. Cities use most energy and other resources and emit most greenhouse gases. Urbanization is proceeding apace round the world. The second great phase of urbanization, it has been called, and an astonishing fact that emerged from one of the IRP reports on cities was that 60% of the urban built environment and infrastructure that will exist in 2050 still remains to be built. How we build that city, those cities, will to a very large extent determine whether we meet our leaders' aspirations at Paris and the Sustainable Development Goals. Aha. Aha. Little battery problem here. Okay, there we are. What will future cities look like? There's an enormous range of possibilities. Now, we don't have, you can't read those titles at the bottom, but they're all names of well-known cities. They don't include either Bristol or Ljubljana, unfortunately. But the red one is Atlanta, and that is that huge area ringed with red. And the smaller green one is Barcelona, a European city. They have a similar population, round about 5 million. You can see that the urban area of Barcelona is about 160 square kilometers, whereas that of Atlanta is over 4,000 square kilometers. And Atlanta has more than 10 times the greenhouse gas emissions per head than Barcelona. Whether our cities come to look like Atlanta or Barcelona in the future will play an enormous role in our quality of life. And I could just as easily have put Bristol or Barcelona or Ljubljana there rather than Barcelona, because Europeans have a long tradition of compact and resourceful cities, which I believe can teach a lot of lessons and impart experiences to other continents. And infrastructure, of course, is key. We have to think in integrated terms of transport and infrastructure for walking, cycling, and public transport. And I've been reading a bit about what you've achieved in that dimension in Ljubljana. And it's terribly impressive, and I hope you may tell us a little bit more about it. Energy, to make cities low-carbon places, electricity and heat distributions. And Bristol has been a prime achiever in that dimension. Water and sewerage, waste management, urban design for nature in the built environment. All these are things which, unless the infrastructure is right, our citizens cannot live resource-conserving lives, even if they want to. And so, to my last slide, the programs in Bristol. I promised George Ferguson I wasn't going to steal his thunder tonight, but I couldn't resist taking just a few words from his website, and the website of Bristol as a green city is truly inspiring. It's a nature-rich city, and nature is incredibly important in cities because we as humans, we're in danger of forgetting that we are natural creatures. We have this kind of sense of division from the natural world. I've talked about resources, the reduction of residual waste, and again, Ljubljana is one of the first cities in Europe on the subject of recycling and waste reduction. Transport, active travel, we've already talked about. Energy and energy efficiency. Bristol has reduced its energy use by 28% since over the last seven or so years. So enormous achievements all. And finally, perhaps we can celebrate food, good food. And that to me, as my last comment, is the key of this celebration of European cities. It's very often the case that environmental issues and environmentalists come over as kind of killjoys. People who are telling other people not to do things and not to go places and not to use things. Actually, the message has to be that it is only through green cities that we will get high human well-being, high quality of life, good food, and good health. Thank you, Bristol and Ljubljana, what you have achieved. Thank you.
Professor Eakins, thank you very much indeed. I think that brings us back to the reality of what we're here for tonight. I realise now I should have asked you to not pick Barcelona, but perhaps to pick Madrid as one of the best performing cities, because the next speaker is my Director General, Daniel Calleja Crespo, and I know he supports Atletico Madrid football team. So, Daniel, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon to everybody. But I like good soccer, and Barcelona right now plays the best soccer. So I would like to welcome you all on behalf of DG Environment, but I think Nick has already done so, to this very important moment, because we are going through what we call the European Green Capital Award handover ceremony. And this is a very important moment, because today we are here to celebrate the success of Bristol, our Green Capital for 2015, to thank Bristol for their excellent work promoting sustainability, promoting urban development. But at the same time, we are also welcoming Ljubljana to this prestigious club. Today you are joining a very exclusive club. And this is the club of the Green Capitals, as Green Capital winner for 2016, you are assuming a very important responsibility. And we will hear from Mayor Ferguson. It's a pleasure to see you here, George, and also from Mayor Jankovic in a moment, about what it means to be a Green Capital winner, what positive impact it brings to the city, to the citizens, what has been your experience, and what are your hopes. Once you are a Green Capital, you are always a Green Capital, or at least that is what we hope. All previous winners, and you see them there, going back to Copenhagen in 2010, still benefit today from the sustainable benefits, from the sustainable investments that they made in urban living. I think it is safe to say that all the cities who have become Green Capitals enter into a virtuous path of sustainability, and this is reflected in the quality of life of the citizens. This is reflected in the environment. This is reflected in a much better life for the citizens, for the people of these cities. And this is what we are seeking, and this is what we all want for our lives, for our children, for our citizens. And today, all these Green Capitals are still showing every day how being green is good for the city, is good for the environment, but it's also good socially, and it's also good economically. So we have this triangle between the environment, the social dimension, and the economic dimension. And we think this is a triple win-win-win for all. Winning the European Green Capital Award means that other cities are going to look to you for inspiration. You become a magnet of inspiration. Bristol has, during 2015, excelled in initiatives, in practices, and we are sure that Ljubljana is going to do the same this year. And there have been very inspiring initiatives. For example, engaging school children to plant thousands of trees in Bristol. I'm not going to speak here about child labor, George, but this has been really a very, very important initiative, because children from early ages already learning the value of the trees, of nature, and this brings a lot of lasting investment in sustainability terms for the cities. Or I could mention what I know Ljubljana is doing, the creation of large ecological zones in the heart of Ljubljana. I think these are also examples of real lasting progress. I have been to Ljubljana. It's a wonderful city, even before you were Green Capital. But it's going to be even more wonderful after this year is gone, because you are going to do many things. In these cities, you can find space for pedestrians and cyclists, better public transport systems, and an increased sense of well-being among people. It's not just seeing the rewards, you can actually hear and feel them too. It's tangible benefits for the population. Winning cities measure and monitor their own performance, and they set real targets for improving a whole range of city problems. This is not just an honor, you get the award. This is about bringing solutions to daily problems. They seek out and encourage innovation and new technology to help solve issues like waste disposal and urban mobility problems. And I think green cities also engage with the citizens. They inform people, they invite them to help make changes happen. They embrace local democracy to leverage cooperation and make improvements. This is not always easy. I remember George telling me about some of the challenges. But I think it's worth engaging in this path because it's the only way forward. Becoming a European Green Capital makes also an important statement about a city's commitment to sustainability. It is a commitment that you are assuming to become more sustainable, and it focuses the attention on how the decision makers have cared about the city environment and the health of the citizens. And this honor is becoming so important that the prestige of being a green capital is going even outside the EU. And many of you will be surprised to know that some countries outside the EU are picking up on the scheme. We hear that the Chinese want to create a similar initiative. And I think this is badly needed in some parts of this country because sustainability is becoming more important. And speaking about China, I would like to mention Shaun the Sheep, this spectator there in the front row. He's already famous in China. And to help engage younger audience in better urban future, Bristol helped to create a very sophisticated computer game where success is gained by building a city from junkyard waste. If you want to try, the address is on Sean's t-shirt. So afterwards, not now, do have a go and see if you can win. But I think this is also an excellent example of using a symbol, Sean the Sheep, and engaging in concrete activities which attract attention. So all of this means that the Green Capital concept is working. The European Commission wants to help cities become more sustainable. Professor Ekins was rightly pointing out the key role that cities have to play in this area. We want to support initiatives to promote innovation, to promote best practices, and all this is in line with our Environment Action Programme, which is the Bible of our action at EU level. Together with the Parliament, with the Member States, the European Commission has agreed this Environmental Action Programme for the next years, and we want to spread the best practices and lessons we have learned from Green Capital winners to all the cities. Be it Green Capital or not, this is the only way forward. We are now developing a monitoring tool for benchmarking that we will launch this year, and cities will be able to use it to monitor, to compare their environmental performance. And I think this should lead to very healthy competition, to see if they can become more sustainable. And this will be based on the Green Capital and on the Green Leaf criteria, because it's not only the capital, we are now having green leaves all over the place. It's the green is growing, and I think it will enable us to access to the best practices we have collected over the years. An initial rollout will be presented at the Green Week later this year. So, I don't want to get carried away with my speech, because there are many important things happening, but I want to conclude saying that today is a day of celebration. Celebration to the achievements of Bristol. Well done, George, well done. You have really put the bar very high. But it is also a moment of handover. And with handover, Ljubljana becomes very powerful as European Green Capital, but with power comes responsibility. And all the attention will be focused on Ljubljana to see if you can provide inspiration and lead with the example to the subsequent green capitals. We count on you. We expect a lot from you. What you are doing, what you have done, is very important for the life of our citizens. It is very important to continue improving the quality of life, to building a sustainable framework, a sustainable ecosystem in which they can conduct their lives. And I want to assure you that you have all the support of the European Commission, of DG Environment, of our commissioner, who will be coming some later, in order to succeed in this very important task. Thank you very much.
Mr. Clay, thank you very much indeed. I hope that was inspiring, but he's my boss, so I have to say that. I'd like next to welcome George Ferguson to the stage. Now, I've met George, I think, 6 or 8 times. His red trousers, if you'll allow me to say, are a hallmark of Bristol's excellence in greenness. So very well done for that. And I've seen posters where people have scrawled graffiti in Bristol referring to George's red trousers, which I found quite rude, and perhaps he does as well. George is going to tell us about what it means in Bristol, what it's meant to Bristol to be green capital, and something about his vision as well, because I've really admired George's vision over the last couple of years we've been associated with Bristol. And one of the most important things I think George has done has involved young people. And just beside George here, you see Neha Mehta and Thanusen Jayaraja, who are Bristol youth mayors. Now that really is, I think, the way to go. George, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicholas, and thank you, Daniel. And I'm just the warm-up act for the youth mayors. And it has been a tremendous privilege being Green Capital for 2015, and it seems just a little bit beyond. And it's been a wonderful opportunity for us to reinforce our determination to become that leading environmental city, taking over from some wonderful cities, directly from Copenhagen, who I see represented here, who were keen to share their experiences of the past 40 years with us, and that has been absolutely tremendous. But with it comes not just that honor, but comes that huge duty. Feel the weight on your shoulders of what you've got to do to make quite sure that we celebrate our achievements and we share those achievements with others. My job has been to pull together a great team. I had a great start, I had some great people in the city. We've been working for 40 years in various ways through civil society. I only came and was elected 3.5 years ago. What a fantastic opportunity to be able to come and pick up that ball that other people had been carrying and just take it across the line. And we have made quite sure that we have, as far as we can, deliver on our promises. We've made some mistakes. We'll share our mistakes. But those mistakes absolutely pale into insignificance compared with the successes that we believe we've had. We've had big investment projects that, of course, have been planned for the last 5, 10 years. But we've started delivering them now. And I think this has given us added impetus. And in energy and transport, we're spending about 500 million euros on schemes across the city region, making thousands more warmer in their homes, reducing their energy bills. We've set up our own energy company with a triple bottom line of dealing with energy poverty, sustainability, and profiting the city so we can reinvest it in sustainability. We've had, over only the last 18 months, a 25% increase in the use of buses, many more people cycling and walking, because I'm being tough on cars. I may lose the next election. But being European Green Capital has helped us build a consensus in the city around our ambition. It's helped us create a national and international buzz around what we're doing. We've used our role to help strengthen the role of cities, and that was really evident at the Paris COP, where cities were the story. We're the people that have the problems on our doorsteps, and we're the people who know what the solutions are so much more than national governments, who are sometimes remote from those solutions. We've been incredibly privileged to work with networks such as Energy Cities and Euro Cities, and Eclay with the Cities and Regions Pavilion at the Paris COP, which we shared with Paris, and I think made a major impact. We returned to Bristol inspired to raise our ambition to go zero carbon by 2050. And I'm so pleased to hear what Paul was saying about the Sustainable Development Goals, because we, each city represented, many, many cities represented at the Cities Pavilion, were showing what our ambition was against those SDGs and that have given us a real desire to make better cities with, as Paul said, good food and good health and good fun. And good fun has been very much part of our year as Green Capital. I have fun with working with children, which is, I think, vitally important. If you have fun, you'll learn quicker, and that has been absolutely at the base of what we've done. And when the commissioner announced the fact that we'd won Green Capital, I remember him saying, and it goes to the city with a sense of fun. But I know from what I've seen and I've heard that Ljubljana will carry on with that sense of fun. We've been working very closely with academics like Paul, the University of Bristol and elsewhere. We created what we call a mini Stern report to show the benefits of a billion pounds, and a bit more would give us in terms of return, not just in terms of economic return, but in terms of social and well-being return. We created a huge knowledge base during 2015, and we've tried to be a role model. City of under half a million, city region of just over a million, very typical European city. Complex, historic, with all the challenges. And I've always said, if you can make it work in Bristol, you can probably make it work anywhere. And so this sharing and learning is vitally important to us. There is no textbook for being European Green Capital. It's a bit like giving birth and wondering what on earth to do. You just get this thing and you think, oh hell, where do I go from here? Well, we hope we've helped with that, with the production of the Bristol Method, which gives many examples of the things we've done. And we would like to feel that that becomes a continuing textbook, which Green Capitals add to, and becomes a greater volume, but beyond the 37 chapter volume that we have produced. It's been a huge pleasure taking the message of green capital across the world, to China, to the States, to South America, now to Africa with our tree planting, with our One Tree Per Child project, shared with others, and I'm now getting messages back from Africa about that, to Korea. And we've had over 70 international delegations to Bristol during our year, which is 7 times what we'd had in previous years. So watch out, Ljubljana. You'll have a lot of hosting to do. And but to me, what's been really important is what we do locally. It's important that we benefit the whole city to bring long-term benefits. We've had this strong civil society organization, the Green Capital Partnership, that has grown enormously over our period since being awarded Green Capital, but has existed now for the last 7 or 8 years. Our objective is to give local empowerment in very many ways. And the youth mayors will be highlighting that in their talk, where we've given grants to over 200 local projects, and we've had over 100,000 hours of volunteering across the city. Volunteering plays a huge part when you're not given much money by the commission. Much would be an exaggeration. But the other great pleasure has been the excitement of our children, with watching them learn in a way that has been really exciting. And I would like to sell you the idea of One Tree Per Child, sell you the idea of Sean learning through Sean. Give it, not sell it. And so now I've got the great pleasure to hand over to my two youth mayors, who have been a tremendous support. They've been our ambassadors during 2015. They're handing over to two new youth mayors next week. I shall miss them, but I'll get two new good ones. So, Niamhetta and Thanushan Jeyaraja, over to you.
Cool. Thank you very much, George, for that introduction. And hello, everyone. So we wanted to highlight how Bristol and our international friends are playing a part in greening our city and other cities across Europe and the world. Green Capital, in our opinion, has focused on 4 key main areas: communities, young people, businesses, and international relationships. So I'd just like to start off by talking about communities and the various projects that we've been doing for this. Bristol has always had a long-standing, active community interested in the environment. This year, under the umbrella of Green Capital, we've aimed to reach new groups and empower the people of Bristol to make our city even greener. We've also ensured that every neighbourhood of the city has benefited from this. In the following video, you'll see a few projects. Some of the highlights include the bike recycling projects for children, the neighbourhood arts project, and our famous big green button as part of the Do 15 campaign. The European Green Capital Year was a catalyst for community activity, providing funding, media coverage, and also helping to show enthusiasm of the local communities, which I hope will be evident from this video.
Hello. Right. As youth mayors, we're delighted that young people have been at the heart of Bristol this year as European Green Capital. There's been lots of activities to raise awareness, educate, and to listen to young people about what they want for the future, which they will inherit. We're proud to say that projects started in Bristol will go on to be a leading legacy that will inspire and educate from those from across the UK and beyond. Furthermore, Bristol's approach towards engaging with young people has been a subtle but effective one. By hosting all sorts of events for the many different age range, Bristol has ensured that no one is left behind. The following video will demonstrate the various projects that have been undertaken and young people's experiences.
Businesses can play an influential role in championing sustainability because they touch all aspects of life: food, energy, transport, and a place to work. We've been able to showcase Bristol's world-leading green technology in the technology businesses in our Green Tech Festival. This has helped them grow, create jobs for the future for young people like us. The Bristol Business Summit was another key event which we were fortunate to be at. We heard from inspirational speakers to business leaders about how they were playing a role in reducing emissions and creating a sustainable city for the future.
As you all know, this year, Bristol has been in the spotlight, and boy, what a year it's been. We have used this opportunity to share our experiences, as well as challenges, to show what our city and its communities are capable of achieving, and to build stronger partnerships for the future. The Commission asked us to share our experiences across Europe, and we have done this, but have taken it global, hosted delegations across the world. Our wonderful mayor has travelled the world flying the European Green Capital flag, and convened the voice of cities at COP21.
Thank you.
European Green Capital has been a great honour for Bristol, and we feel we have lived up to the trust which the Commission placed in us by giving us the title.
It is leading to real changes within the city. As representatives of young people of Bristol, we want to see a few things for the future.
Sustainability. We want to see a reduction in the consumption of bottled water. Bristol has made a huge effort to do this by building the iconic Bristol Blue Whales made from wicker and plastic bottles. We have also set up refill stations around the city as part of Refill Bristol. But the ever-increasing amount of plastic polluting our oceans, it's our obligation to stop using single-use plastics.
Involvement of youth, young people. Bristol has hosted many events throughout its year as European Green Capital, but one of the most young people-orientated events that was carried out was the Bristol Green Youth Day, which was primarily centred around educating and interacting with young people and about issues regarding the environment. In addition, there were inspirational speakers, films and demonstrations from people who have been campaigning on helping change Bristol.
Equal opportunities for all. As with every city, there is inequality. To bridge this gap, we want to see increased investment in youth provision within disadvantaged areas.
One of the major projects that was carried out in Bristol last year was the opening of Fieldwood Business Park, which was funded by the European Union. Situated in one of the more disadvantaged areas of Bristol, this new project has allowed aspiring young individuals to make change and really progress in life.
We would like to ask policymakers here today to consider what actions they will be taking for a better urban environment. Thank you all for listening to us, and remember, this is only the future.
Thank you, Nia and Tanushin. I think you can see our future is pretty well secured, and they'll be nibbling at my ankles. European Green Capital. Welcome, Commissioner. Wonderful to see you, fellow architect, friend, and as is the whole Commission, the way you have supported us has been tremendous, and I want to particularly thank Carl, who I always describe as a bit of the godfather of European Green Capital, who gave us so much support and even cycled over. To see us. It's wonderful to see you, Carl, and to see you've not been buried. And Friday marked the end of our Green Capital, but it wasn't the end. It was a great celebration, and we had 800 people coming to celebrate and a handful of protesters, because in Bristol, it wouldn't be Bristol if we didn't have some protesters. And we committed to further action. It doesn't stop here, and I think that's really important, that once a green capital, always a green capital, as Daniel said. And we had businesses, we had politicians, we had civil society, and it's civil society that I think will ensure the legacy to implement new sustainable strategies, not just what we know. And I know that Nia and Tanushin know that I say that I have a collective term for those who resist change, the change that is necessary. That's adults. And the young people are so much readier for that change, but those of us who are still young in mind are ready for it. That applies to all of you in this room, of course. But we want to also be a city of learning, a city of innovation, a city of culture, and we have used all those things, and we'll be applying for all those things and under European status, we hope, because Bristol is a very European city, and we believe in Europe very, very strongly. And so I can take a message from the cities of the UK, who generally are very much very much look to Europe as their friends. We will continue to work with our sister green capitals, who we regard as sister cities, special sister cities, and with aspiring capitals. And I want to reiterate our willingness to share. And Zoran and Chasha, we will be, and all Ljubljana that's represented here, we will so enjoy sharing with you. And I look forward to coming out in the summer, because I'm told that's the best time to come out. Because I haven't been to Ljubljana since before most of you were born. I went there as a student and was most welcome. And I look forward to see the changes that have taken place in 50 years. But so thanks to all. Thank you, Daniel. You have taken up the cudgel with so much enthusiasm. It's been tremendous. I didn't think anybody would be able to follow Carl. You have followed him spectacularly. You gave us great support at the Paris COP. And I thank you very, very much for that. And so I look forward now to being able to hand over to my new friends. Actually, we've become old friends now. It's been about 2.5 years, 3 years, to Ljubljana, who I know will do a wonderful job. So, skrečno, Ljubljana. Oh, you want me back there? Yeah.
Thank you very much indeed, George. One of the measures of George's success, you mentioned parking, and you should see the letters we get about George's decisions on parking here in Europe. So, quite something. Next, we move towards Ljubljana. I think we are quite convinced now that Bristol has been a very worthy green capital. A lot of evidence and a lot more to learn about Bristol in the future. We move towards Ljubljana now, and we're going to begin by looking at a video which shows a bit about what Ljubljana's really like. So we strike the video. Thank you.
Himno zelene prestolnice Evrope 2016. Tore, da parkiram jaz tole svojo makino, kar snemite, da se vidi, da ste se z biciklom parkelo.
Delo vseh mojih sodelavcev v celotni mesti družini in pa na vsakega Ljubljančana, Ljubljančko, ki svojim majhnim prispevkom pokaže in prispeva, da hranimo Ljubljano tako lepo tudi za naslednje generacije.
Jaz sem zelo vesel, da lahko v Ljubljani živim.
Jaz mislim, da je danes zelo lepo, no? Da malo tukaj praznujemo tudi Ljubljano. Ne? In dejansko Ljubljana je zelena mesta, ki meni osebno zelo všeč.
Ob otvoritvi zelene prestolnice Ljubljane smo pripravili znameniti jezerško šmoron, ki pa smo ga tokrat zaradi te zelene note pripravili malo drugačen, sicer iz lokalne ljubljanske nabavne poti in na ta način v zrak spustili manj CO2.
Ljubljana 2016!
Ljubljana 2016!
I think we can already see some similarities there. Ljubljana clearly has a sense of fun, and you might have caught a glimpse of the dragon there. The dragon is called Flora, and I hope we can introduce Flora to Sean, and who knows what might happen. It's next my honor to introduce Tiasza Fitzko, who I've already met a couple of times. We have in our beautiful building here in Brussels a Beaulieu Café, which is a kind of an in-house meeting every now and again, where we have our in-house band and some serious talking as well. And Tiasza was a guest at our last Beaulieu Café, so the staff of DG Environment, the Environment Directorate General, already know you, so that's quite something. Tiasza, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this really kind introduction. Dear Commissioner, estimated guests, dear friends, George, thank you for kind words that you told us about Ljubljana, about our collaboration. And like you could see, we just wanted to share with you a few highlights of our opening ceremony, small opening ceremony that we had in front of our city hall on the January 13th, where children sang our green anthem. And as it was already said, we have a new green mascot, our dragon lady called Flora. We've opened wooden pavilions that will be really very much alive for the whole year. And you could also see our big heart. We've been measuring our heartbeat because we are green at heart, and our hearts beat for Ljubljana, European Green Capital 2016. We started early, I know. We couldn't wait for official handover ceremony that we are witnessing today. But you know, if you ask me why, it's really simple, because our citizens, people that live in Ljubljana, are our most important stakeholder group, so we just wanted to start the year for them, because they are the reason we've been taking part in the project of European Green Capital. They are the reason we decided to learn, to grow, and they are the reason that we are here today. Ljubljana is European Green Capital because it was said that it is a city that has done the biggest difference in the right direction in the shortest period of time. We are proud of that. We are, for now, the first and only European Green Capital in the whole central and southeastern part of Europe. And we know it is a huge responsibility. We decided to really take this responsibility. We are doing a lot of communication with informing other cities around us about the project. We are already, like Daniel said, we are already having a lot of interest, not only from European cities, but from the cities all around the world. The delegations are coming to Ljubljana. They are trying to learn. And we are, of course, sharing our good practices with them. And hopefully, we will motivate as much as possible to decide to join us at this big green family and decide to apply for this award. Ljubljana is a city with a green soul. That's a fact. We are actively preserving our really intense green character. We are, as you may know, we have almost three quarters of all the surfaces in Ljubljana are green areas, and we have 542 square meters per capita of public green areas, which we are really proud of. And we are not only preserving that, but we are also increasing this number, because we are not only preserving our natural advantages like green areas, like high quality potable water, like really rich biodiversity, but we are also changing the areas really actively that not so long ago were really far from being green and far from being sustainable. We have changed more than 80 hectares of formerly brownfield areas of illegal waste dumps and illegal allotments into really high quality green areas that are meant for recreation, for sports, that are really open to public and that anyone can enjoy. And it was already said that the biggest challenge that we have met when we came in 2007 and when we have designed our sustainable vision, the biggest challenge was our traffic. And I think the biggest step that we have done was to implement sustainable mobility. And I think it was one of our great accomplishments. Don't understand me wrong. I'm not saying we already have finished. We have a lot of challenges in front of us, but we are on the right way. And I think the field of sustainable mobility, the most popular and famous project, of course, was closing the city center for all the motorized traffic and open it for pedestrians. And I'm not talking about only a street or two. I'm talking of an area that is bigger than 10 hectares. And we have changed the quality of living there, that's for sure. I want to stress another thing, that changes in Ljubljana do happen really fast. If I just look for last 6 to 8 months what we have done, I could stay here for hours telling you all of them. We have opened the biggest environmental cohesional project, and it's the Regional Waste Management Center, which with which we are solving the waste management issues for more than a third of the whole country's population. That's more than 700,000 people, or we are talking about 37 municipalities. We have extended our park and ride system. We have upgraded it with the charging points because we are actively implementing our electromobility strategy. We have built a port on the river Ljubljanica. We have done smaller and bigger projects. Like smaller, we have opened a special bee and honey trail. We have done a really small steps, but they really can contribute a lot. What I believe it's important in saying, in counting all of that project, is that, of course, we've been talking about the vision. It's important to have a vision, to have a dream, but there's other thing that I believe is more important, and it's harder to achieve, and that is to have the courage to implement this vision, to have the courage to put your dream into reality, because you have to decide and you have to, you know, meet even really challenging questions, even if at that right moment not everyone agrees. And we have always had these really ambitious goals, because I think they are necessary to then have the exceptional results. And that's why I really have to say thank you to our mayor at this point, because he was the one who really, you know, decided that we have to do something. He decided to close the city center for traffic, and we've done that. He decided to put away the illegal allotments, and we've done that. So it was not always easy. No, it was never easy. It was always challenging and is really dynamic, but it has been a really special and great journey for us so far. I have to be honest with you that a vast majority of all the green projects that we have implemented since 2007 would have been implemented probably even if we wouldn't be European Green Capital. But there has been a really important change, a really important switch because of this award, the highest award that a city can get. I believe that really strongly. And that is that it has changed our point of view. It has changed our way of thinking. Now everything has to do something with green. We are always thinking green. We are always measuring green effects. We are connecting green to sport, green to culture, green to education, green to health, to social care, to children, to elderly. We are always measuring the green results and the green effects of what we are doing. And we believe that this is the key, because today the whole so-called big city family, and we are more than 12,000, actually 12,089 at the moment, we really think green, and we have to, that is the first condition. You have to believe in a story so that you can then convince someone else to believe in it. So that was the first step for us. We believe in green, and I think we are doing a good job now in actively convincing our citizens in going green, in being green, in thinking green. I believe we've been really successful so far. I don't want to be falsely modest. Because people are, you know, sensible to their environment. They are sensible to green. That means that they are more demanding. But at the same time, it means that they give us more ideas, more propositions, also more critics. But we grow together, and together we are better, and we can reach higher. And I think that is all about the whole story. And another thing that I have seen now on the streets is that people not only know that we are European capital, but they're also getting there. They're, you know, proud of being a city that is European green capital. And that is important, because people that are proud on that, they're also motivated to do their own small or bigger steps for better environment, for greener Ljubljana. They are contributing, you know, to better quality of living in our city, and that is actually our ultimate goal that we wanted to achieve. What is in front of us? We have already started this year. We have divided the whole year into 12 chapters. Every month we are concentrating on one sustainable topic. We started in January with waste management, with sustainable waste management. As you may know, we are the European capital with the highest share of separately collected waste, and we're really proud of that. We adopted a zero waste strategy, another really ambitious goal that we decided to follow. And this month, we are having another topic, and that is local production and self-sufficiency. So a lot of different workshops, a lot of different generations, a lot of different stakeholder groups, crowding, brainstorming, finding new ideas, finding new solution. Next month, there will be a month of water, and so on. This year is not only a year when we have the possibility to share our good experiences, to learn. It's important. But we are also making new partnerships. We are meeting new stakeholders, new partners, and we are creating something, you know, new results. And for example, there are really interesting ideas what we will do. Out of invasive plants, for example, we will produce some really useful products, from bags to wrapping paper and so on. Out of waste packaging, we will produce dish towels and hygienic paper. Then we are creating a partnership together with a project so-called Green Light World Flight, when there is a story about globally measuring the black carbon concentrations with flying on a journey around the world. So there are really good stories that will be creating and following this year. Of course, you'll be all warmly invited to Ljubljana at least 3 times, but of course you are really warmly invited anytime. But we will start at the March 10th with the opening ceremony, big opening ceremony. I promise you, you won't regret if you'll be there with us. We'll be in Ljubljana in the end of May, at the beginning of Green Week, and of course, hopefully, we'll all meet in Ljubljana on 21st and 22nd of June, when there'll be a new European Green Capital Declaration of 2018. So it will be a really dynamic year in front of us. I'm looking forward. I know it won't be easy. Far from it. It's never easy, but you know, when it's not easy, then it's not so satisfying. So it's good that it's dynamic, that it's hard, because then the results can be really exceptional. I don't know if now is a possibility that I would just switch to another really beautiful European language, and that's Slovene language, just for a couple of sentences. I don't know if is a possibility. Yes. Thank you, really. I have here a lot of friends and my co-workers. That's why veselje in ponos mi je, da lahko danes stojim na tem odru. A boste sproti?
It is my great pleasure and honor to be able to...
Ah, please. Lahko sproti.
It is my great pleasure and honor to be able to stand at this podium today.
In da lahko v imenu vseh nas, ki smo tukaj, predstavljam Ljubljano.
And to represent Ljubljana on behalf of everyone who's here from Ljubljana today.
Da smo vsi skupaj ponosni na to nagrado.
I think that we are all proud of this award.
In vem, da vsi skupaj vemo, da je to daleč od ležanja in počivanja na lovorikah.
And I know that we all know that this does not mean that we will be resting on our laurels from now on.
Pred nami je še veliko.
There are many challenges in front of us.
In prepričana sem, da jih bomo ne le dosegli, ampak skupaj tudi presegli.
And I'm convinced that we will not only fulfill these challenges but also overcome them.
In z vsem spoštovanjem do vseh ostalih evropskih zelenih prestolnic.
And with all due respect to all the other green capitals of Europe.
Sem prepričana, da bomo ostali v spominu kot najboljša evropska zelena prestolnica.
I am convinced that we will remain in everyone's memory as the best green capital of Europe.
I will conclude in a minute. Just let me express my gratitude to a person that really motivated me to stay in the project, to grow with the project, to learn. I'm high, and that is, I'm now the second one to repeat that, but that is Mr. Karl Falkenberg. Thank you really much. Dankeschön für alles, Karl. You've been an inspiration and a lot of help. Thank you really. Thank you very much. Thank you everyone for letting me share this small piece of our great green story that we'll be living this year. And as I said, you are really warmly welcome to Ljubljana this year and anytime. Thank you.
I think we'll already agree that Carl is the honorary grandfather of Green Capital. Next, it's my honor to welcome to the stage the man with the vision, the man with the courage, to Ljubljana Green Capital, Mr. Zoran Janković.
Another grandfather. Good evening, and for the beginning, I want to invite you to the great concert in 1 hour, that our gift from Ljubljana, also Brizani is our citizen, and you will enjoy there. But first, Karl, I wish all the best for the next election. You became an old friend, and I think that we need such great persons in this project. I'm really proud to be the part of this great event because this award is the highest award between cities. And all of us must do everything to increase the importance of this award, not only in Europe. I remember remember in 2006 when I went the first time the election for the mayor with a small team of 7 persons. Tasha was one of them. At that time, we didn't know anything about Green Capital of Europe. This award wasn't launched. And we started with normal business plan because I came from the business, started with Vision Ljubljana 2025, with our strategy, with our goals, and with the project. And during the last 9 years, we made more than 1,700 projects. I didn't take your time to tell about all of them. But first, I want to tell thank you to our citizens for supporting this team. I have the best team. Supporting this team 4 times in the election. I won 4 times, always in direct election, and every time in the first round with more than 60%. That's the work of my team. I'm just for photo shooting and for speeches. And after that, we started with this, some ideas which you can see now in the to close the city center. Ne? We had this idea on our table for the last 50 years. And one day, I decided to close this street, invited the workers, ne? And started to, I don't know why, ne? What, ne? But we were there and closed the city, this street. After that, never opened the city center for traffic. More than 10 hectares. But this award is a practical experience. In last 6-7 months, I got so many answers for the most important questions. If for all the mayors, we are special type of people or special animals. I don't know never what it's closer to you. But the first is the quality of life of our citizens. To make this life better and better. But this is not enough. The second question is about solidarity. In Europe, we have now a big problem about solidarity. Refugees, but not the only one. It's our environment, solidarity for the future generations. If we can give them this environment so beauty, so healthy, as we got several years ago. The third question and answer is business. After we got this award, the highest award, Ljubljana became also the touristic destination for future in Madrid. And I learned in Madrid, for me, the greatest project, Rio Madrid. And that's my dream, to get Ljubljana, Rio Ljubljana railway, not for the traffic, but for the living. That's for me. But after we got this second award, the number of tourists increased in last year for 18%. We started 8 years ago with 400,000 nights. Last year we finished with 1.1 nights. And our goal is in 3 years to have 3 million nights, but just 1 million tourists to stay 3 days in Ljubljana. After this award, it's also important for me that all doors of the mayors of the biggest city, of the biggest capitals, became open for me. Before that, it was really, really difficult to come to see the mayor of Paris, to change experience or to Berlin. Now, it's not a problem. Because Ljubljana is really green capital of Europe, for this part of Europe. But also, this award give the courage to the private investors. We got the first contract for the first hotel with 5 stars, Intercontinental, and started to build that 2 months ago. After 8 years trying to sign the contract, we signed the contract with IKEA, the first shopping mall IKEA in Slovenia. And other private investors looking our city on a different way. And that's the importance of this award. And that's my question. I don't want to take your time to tell you everything about Ljubljana, because it's easy. You must come to see Ljubljana, to feel Ljubljana. If I tell you about Ljubljana, Ljubljana is a green city. 542 square meters per citizen. I remember well. It's a clean city. The first award this year, Janko, where is? The general manager of Ars Naga is the best manager in this part of business. Ne? It's a safe city. That's important, especially this time. Ne? We started with these events ne? On November 27th, finished January 2nd. In the city center, we had more than a million visitors, but without anything and friendly city. Just look me. Ne? At the end, ne? I remember one poem, ne? Simply the best, but for Ljubljana is simply the most beautiful city in the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed. The commissioners of the European Commission change every 5 years, and with Mr. Vella, I think I struck lucky because I didn't have to explain green capital to him. He's a former architect. He probably knows more about it before I began than I do, so that's very lucky. Mr. Vella, this floor is yours. Mr. Vella is the commissioner not only for environment but for fisheries and marine affairs as well, so he has a very large dossier. So I hope you'll tell us that environment is the most interesting one, of course.
Thank you.
I don't need to tell that to anyone because everyone already knows that. And so, Mayor Ferguson, Mayor Jankovic, Tiasha, and thank you for your inspiring speech coming right out from your heart. Daniel, father of this Carl, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening to all. And please forgive me for not being here from the very beginning, but I was traveling, I was on my way from Sicily. But I didn't want to miss this opportunity. I didn't want to miss the opportunity of thanking our colleague George, who's always with the red trousers, so today I decided to come in my red tie. And to congratulate Ljubljana as well. And thank you for turning out for handing over ceremony tonight. Again, a special welcome to our past champions, Bristol, and to Ljubljana, the city that will now carry the torch. You will have now to carry the flame. And may the torch burn as brightly in Slovenia as it has done so in the West Coast, and I'm sure that it will. Tonight is a ceremonial occasion in this rather splendid setting, but it's not just a formal occasion, it's also a chance to remind ourselves of the value of this award and of how it can serve as an inspiration. We're not talking only about the city's infrastructure here, but as Tiasha said, we're talking about a whole mindset, we're talking about a whole mentality. And looking back over the past year, Bristol has been, I have to say, one of the greatest ambassadors that we've had, with an impressive focus on the human aspects of greening our cities. And when I visited last summer, I was particularly very, very much impressed at the number of young people that were getting involved. This has already been mentioned before, and I think I need to stress it as well. And now I hear at the close of the year that these really were young people of all ages, from the 74 primary schools that took part to the 100,000 hours of volunteering from university students. It is very encouraging to see this new generation of fresh activists being motivated to green our urban centers. And that is the right guarantee that we need, the right guarantee that we want that for a better green future as well. And it's a fine way of ensuring that the legacy of Bristol's year as a green will live on. This is not saying goodbye to George. No, rest. You have to work even harder now to make your following cities even better than Bristol. And marking the lives of young citizens in this great city of yours, George. So thank you, Bristol, and now turn to Ljubljana. Your lively, informative presentation is a clear sign that you will be bringing as much to the award as has already been explained by the mayor and Yasha, as this award will be bringing to Ljubljana, as this award will be bringing to your citizens, to your business community, to tourists traveling to Ljubljana as well. And from the very beginning, the idea behind the award was to encourage cities to focus on the sustainable urban planning. More than anything, we wanted to show how thinking for the longer term can pay immediate dividends, and how this process can continue not for 1 year, not for 2 years, but for a very long time to come. It pays off for numerous reasons, of course. For example, investments that help citizens use water and energy more efficiently will generate costs downstream, both for industry and for the citizens themselves. But major planning decisions cannot be taken lightly. Citizens need to be convinced of their value, and it takes a degree of courage on the part of the city authorities, as we've heard from George and as we've heard from Mayor Yankovic. And don't worry about losing your election, George. You will not. I'm sure you will not. That courage was clearly there by both mayors, where Ljubljana created its large traffic zone. That must have been a real courageous move. But it's well worth it, I'm sure. And the benefits for all are very clear. It is not just a matter of cleaner air. There are also reduced health costs and a greater sense of well-being. If you have been to Ljubljana before and after the creation of the large pedestrianized zone, I'm sure that everyone will understand the importance of the decision that has been taken. You can energize a city, and you can build not only civic pride, but also an additional economic activity. Since the decision was taken, business and tourism have continued to thrive and even grow in the historical center. And I am certain that tourism will continue to flow, and because this is the kind of cities that tourism want. This is the kind of tourism that visitors look for. But obviously from the tourists, those benefiting mostly from the improvements of the cities are, and we cannot forget them, the citizens themselves. What we do and when we do something in our destinations, we don't simply do it for the tourists, but primarily we also do it for our citizens. And thinking about the environment often starts with thinking about what our citizens really want. But these decisions only work if they are part of a wider commitment. They need to be part of an effort to build more intelligent transport networks with lower noise levels, better air quality, and well-planned green spaces. And that is precisely the salt of all-round approach that so impressed the jury when Ljubljana applied for this title. Ljubljana, I hope you make the most of the year, and I will be visiting to experience, to feel on the progress that has been made, and hopefully I will be coming soon in the coming weeks. My visit is already planned. And before we turn the page in the Green Book, I would like to say just a few words about the future of the Capital Award itself. The Commission is strongly committed to the Green Capital Initiative. As everyone knows, it's Carl's baby, and Carl is very happy that we are all taking care of his baby. It's growing, and it's growing strong. And to the new award for the smaller cities. And we have noticed that even for cities that do not win, being part of the process itself has been for them a very positive and a very useful experience. Bringing together the different players around one table, thinking about how to work together to create the sustainable city that in itself is already a major step forward. And the Commission too. We have also learned a lot from the award. And as a result, as already mentioned, I think, by Daniel, we are developing a new tool that any citizen, any city can use to benchmark and to monitor environmental performance. It is voluntary and it's based on the 12 criteria that we use to judge our green capital. If it can usefully influence the urban planning process, then it will be a great success, and I am sure it will be. Not just for cities that win awards, but for any city, even those that are just beginning to think about urban sustainability. We hope it will help city-level decision makers to allocate resources more effectively in support of a better environment. That, in turn, should help ensure the long-term economic and social well-being, and the aim is to launch a pilot version of this initiative in June. These three initiatives, the Green Capital, the Green Leaf, and the new benchmarking tool, are part of an emerging EU urban agenda, which you will hear more about in the course of this year. We are working closely with our colleagues in other Commission departments and with the Dutch presidency towards a more comprehensive set of ideas and actions. And my hope is that EU ministers will sign the document, which we are calling the Amsterdam Pact, in coming May. The pact recognizes much more clearly the importance of cities in the policy-making process in terms of the role that they play and the influence that they have. And I am sure Bristol and Ljubljana can both relate to that much more than I can. To conclude, congratulations again to both cities and best of luck for the green future. And now, the formal highlight of our evening, the formal highlight that Ljubljana has been waiting for. It is time to hand over the official Green Book to Ljubljana, our new capital for 2016 and way beyond. Thank you, Ljubljana, and thank you, George. Thank you very much.
Take a seat there for a second.
Okay.
The Green Book, which Commissioner Vella referred to, it's new pages for every successive Green Capital, and I'm rather hoping that someone will tell me where the Green Book is. Two mayors and the commissioner to turn the page, please. Now we have the beginning of a new green capital year, and congratulations again to Ljubljana. The only thing left for me to do is to thank everybody for coming this evening, particularly Your Excellency and your wife, the Ambassador from Slovenia, and Madam. Thank you very much for coming and representing with your colleagues from Slovenia here the success of Ljubljana, and congratulations to your whole country. There is a cocktail reception awaiting you upstairs. We're on the 8th floor, so it's on the 9th floor, and I warmly invite you to go and, I should say, do some networking, but that makes it far too official, just to enjoy yourselves the rest of the evening. Thank you very much indeed, and goodbye.